Well, the idea is that we can now get smart suggestions into your mind. Thanks, go ahead. Roll tag is missing for the roll program. Something about the user interface. Oops. Again. These are all auto-generated, so the more people tag, the more it will find structure, the more it will give more suggestions.
It's basically the same algorithm that I'm using for the old popcorn database, which is only for tags. So it's just statistical. So
yeah.
It's also adopting.
Yeah. I looked up what Google uses for the what technology Google uses for the for data mining, and they use MapReduce.
And MapReduce.
Yes, that's the infrastructure.
Okay.
They are it's described on. Wikipedia, if you look for MapReduce there, and they, it's a network of distributed machines.
MapReduce. Okay.
And you actually have to fill in the scripts doing the analysis and stuff to into the system.
That's the thing somebody suggested to me yesterday. Is it? Somebody said to me there's a system because I was wondering with I couldn't just remember the name.
There's actually a free implementation of that, which is
several.
Which is called Hadoop for the Apache project.
And there's even what do you call it?
Hadoop.
Association analysis?
An Eclipse plugin that helps you create the scripts that you need to run this.
Well, Eclipse doesn't run for me, really. It crashes most of the time.
But the juice is just a very generalized infrastructure to make it easy to run jobs in parallel.
It's basically a distributed computational library.
Yes, that's...
PVM or LDI?
In order to quickly do data mining. They apparently can render or remap or re-mine their whole data set in one night or one day or so, but that's okay. Of course, they have also some big data centers doing this.
Yeah, they have really big data centers. I have just one computer.
No use for distributed in one computer.
Well, it has two cores. So maybe.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay, is there anything that somebody really wants to talk about first?
Tegger, do you want to say something?
Sure. I don't know if I want to go first. So there was a lot of discussion in the during your session yesterday.
Yeah.
Were there things that people still wanted to talk about? I had a data mining project that I'm working on that I wanted to talk to people about, but I thought maybe since it's a bot, we should talk about other things. I don't know.
I'm here interested more in the hardware type stuff. If we could somehow get that going. It came out of the Wacky Ideas session. Just because Ubuntu are doing it. I think even Red Hat are doing it.
Fedora has a project in Fedora.
Yeah, Fedora are doing it. So we should be doing it.
Well, we could first talk about what we should line together, what data, or we could talk about the security implications. Because it's got another security privacy implications. Because I'm a bit afraid collecting too much information.
Petter knows a little bit more about that. I don't know what Petter wants to talk about. Petter?
Yeah.
Well, you were telling me about the security implications.
Yes, there is some information collected by DMI decode that is a bit risky to spread around. Like serial numbers for the machines. Hmm?
What is DMI decode?
DMI data, desktop management infrastructure.
It's an old PC BIOS thing that queries the BIOS and gets hardware information strings back.
Yeah, it gets
what's on the motherboard? What's the connector on the motherboard?
It's one of the things HWinfo can call itself, so you can actually use HWinfo and call that. And I can show you the output of it.
Yeah,
so
I think
includes
the output of HWinfo.
It includes information that a company would not want to spread around to to everyone.
Like, and stuff that may be unique enough that it could be tracked back to a particular machine, maybe? Yeah.
Well, definitely, there's a serial number that's supposed to be unique. So
and then you do ID, which is
processor
IDs.
Yeah.
I think when we had the. So we talked about the wacky ideas, we were just talking about collecting PCI IDs.
Well, they are safe.
Why don't we do less is more, just collect PCI IDs? I mean, we can accomplish a lot with that.
There's a few steps we can do PCI ID. USB IDs are very easy.
The problem with the USB IDs is that some things might not always be on. So it's a bit sort of when we're collecting it. But anyway,
yeah, by on, you mean logged in versus loaded and working?
I think it's connected to the machine or not.
Yeah, there's nothing we can do about that. But just plugged in and knowing they're on the bus is interesting. Even if there's not a driver, it's interesting to know that. You know, this many people running Debian have this device.
Yeah,
well, but you do want to have some information from the DMI decode, like the vendor and model of your hardware. So HP ProLiant, for example, would be present in the DMI decode information. If it's a laptop or a standalone machine, if it supports IPMI or not, if it's what kind of CPUs it got, how much memory it got, that kind of information is present in the DMI tables. So that's why we collect DMI decode, at least at the university, from all the machines, because it's filled with useful information. But some of that useful information is not something you spread around, because serial numbers and stuff like that, you don't want to spread it too far.
We could choose to only grab some identified DMI types and say, we grab types about CPU, about motherboard, but we retrieve. Since it's standardized, we can say type CPU. We just ring the serial number and upload
it. The architecture is already categorized. Not like it's Pentium or an Athlon or whatever.
It's just
the architecture. We already got that.
Yeah.
We're talking about architecture like Popcorn.
If it's ARM, if it's
I was wondering about
that data we could get from ProxyCPUinfo as well. But I think what's more interesting about the DMI decode is the fact that it actually lists who the vendor was that shipped it. So like most PCs will show up and you'll see, oh yes, it's an Intel processor or whatever, but you won't know who made the motherboard or other information about that.
But there's a way to collect that too, right? Not that I really want that. I mean, I'm thinking memory, the mainboard. Supplies maybe a bit too much.
Actually, even that info is interesting because if someone approaches the mainboard manufacturer, it's much easier to talk to the mainboard manufacturer saying, hey, we are Debian and we have about 50,000 machines running Debian on your motherboard that sucks. And how could you improve your motherboard so it works better with, for us?
Okay.
But that's not really a problem. There is an implementation of Debian packet available from Ubuntu with a server we can set up and just install and let the users ship us information. So all we need is someone to do it.
So it's just like Popcorn, people just opt in.
Yeah. Okay. It's normally a one-time job.
Why does it need a server, though?
To receive it.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Why not add an option to Popcorn, but to HWinfo or whatever? Saying deprivatize or
yeah, scrub.
Huh? Scrub.
Scrub. Scrub the any unique information from DMI decode or something.
Yeah. Is that
and that be the default? No, I'm just saying, he's saying implement that.
Right, yeah, it would be.
That's
thing.
Sorry, that one.
Of course, it's problematic to know what all kinds of machines have, what kind of privacy information they have there, because it's not very standardized. Some of it is pretty obvious. The serial number you can take away.
Yeah, well, start with
but
obvious.
Well, yeah, okay. Just be aware that it's a complex problem, so you will, you might miss something.
Yeah, but we at least tried.
Yeah. I'm not sure if that's a good idea.
His point is, you started and you take responsibility for it and you maintain it in the future, it's happening.
Yeah, sure. But my point is that if you try and fail, it might be, it might look worse than if you just announce that we are not trying to provide your, to protect your privacy. Do you still want to submit? Because they don't, then there is no expectation that we will actually try.
Pardon again? If I say we try to protect your privacy?
Yeah, and fail, then people will have reason to be really angry. But if we start by saying we do not try to protect your privacy, do you still want to participate? They do not have any expectation that we will try to protect their privacy. And
but
if they still participate...
Why should we say so?
Hmm?
But we want to, why should we say so?
Because we might get more pissed off people if we fail that way than if we don't try and, well, then we can't fail.
We could come from the other way though and just include information you know is safe. Rather than exclude information
Sure, that's possible. That's probably easier, because then we know what we actually are collecting.
The problem is that you can never enlarge the data set. I mean, when you decide what you collect, it's really difficult to add one extra thing.
Yeah, we have that in popularity contest.
In Popcorn, that's exactly that problem, yeah. If you wanted to mine something else, you needed to have, you know, like a DevConf question to all the users saying, oh, by the way, can I also take note of this? And then people would say no, people would be upset.
Yeah.
So
we could like define a minimized additional hardware set of information, and the full information, and let the user decide, like everything, just minimalized set or like nothing about
it. Yeah, the question is how useful it is to do it, because what you collect is the data you need. And can you make use of stripped down versions of data? Because every in statistics, every time you give the user a chance of influencing the data you get, that introduces bias on your data set in a way or another.
I suspect it's easier to do it the Ubuntu way, where you have a menu entry, submit your information about your hardware to the developers, and it just tells you that it will submit a lot of information that contains blah blah blah. Are you okay with this? Yes, and there it goes.
Well, the Ubuntu way is very good because Ubuntu does it already, so we won't be more assholes than them. Not meaning
awesome.
That we kind of have the way paved by other people doing it. So you don't have to do the whole show that you are responsible, is it good or evil thing, which is the question every time you start a data collection.
hwdb.ubuntu.com, that's the...
No, so you say that slower again?
Hmm?
To say that, to repeat that.
hwdb, hardwaredatabase.ubuntu.com.
But is that really, is that, would that be helpful? Because I know that they have a totally different kernel than we do.
Hmm?
Would that be helpful? They have a very different kernel than we do, and knowing...
Oh, but the kernel is not important. They provide the LSPCI output, the LSUSB output, the DMI decode output. A lot of information that describes the hardware. The kernel is something else. They also collect information if the sound card is working, your headset
exactly,
working, that's
what I was talking about.
That's a minor thing.
One question is, do you want it correlated with the packages? So to share the same hash?
Yeah.
No.
I don't
together?
Think so.
Because
for
what
that,
was
for
the
data mining, it would be... that would be very helpful, because then you could map specific hardware to specific packages.
This guy's got a server. More important, he uses package set X. This guy's got a desktop and he uses package set Y.
So you can give suggestions saying that start from your hardware really. So I see you have, you know, an Intel video card, and many people who have an Intel video card have this and this package installed.
Sure.
And they keep told me they're all wrong and you should get rid of it because the driver, it breaks if you use them. But that's a different question.
I see that it's very useful to collect that kind of information, and I'm also pretty sure I would not participate if we collected it.
Right.
But
then it's you. So hold on.
If you don't connect it, it's not pretty useful. We can do statistics about what we have, but not we can't do data mining on it.
Well, trust me, it would be very useful because I would be able to detect which PCI IDs that are not currently detected by the kernel modules and figure out what kernel module is supposed to support it. I would also be able to check what kind of models are currently used by Debian and, for example, approach HP or IBM and say, we have like 200,000 users of your ProLiant server, can you make sure that your drivers work properly? That kind of information would be very useful, even if you don't correlate it with the package list.
Okay, from my point of view, for this, what I'm doing is it's not helpful
right
anymore. So.
What would you be ready to give? What kind of would you be ready to give your PCI ID, the list of your PCI IDs?
Yes.
Would you be would you have problem giving your USB IDs?
No.
Would you have problem giving within DMID code specifically?
Not me personally, but as an enterprise at the University of Oslo,
yeah,
people would have problems doing that. Yeah.
Because any enterprise wouldn't like to disclose the kind of hardware they have because that tells who they source it from.
Well, that's no problem as long as it's anonymous. You can track them down, but if you actually provide the serial number of the machine, anyone can contact the vendor and ask for support for that serial number.
Serial number is a really bad idea, but the if I'm the internet provider of a big university, I'm also probably a big enterprise selling hardware, and if the mails are unencrypted, which is likely, then I kind of see what kind of hardware the university uses and go back with offers and stuff.
Yeah,
but you already know for software. I mean,
but that's not a problem. People sell hardware, not free software.
Even if we stripped out serial numbers and that sort of thing, you still might be able to infer who a particular user is if they have enough machines of a certain type or whatever. Like, you know, Google happened to be running Debian and they turned this on, all of a sudden we saw that there were more machines of this one type than anything else. You might be able to figure out that's Google or something, you know what I mean? It might be best to defer to the user to decide whether or not the information is sensitive to them. And it would be nice if, for all the different categories that we had that we were collecting things, somewhere in the conf file we had, or ideally with devconf, we just had little checkboxes that said, you know, do you want to send information from proxy PU info? Do you want to send PCI?
No, that's not too much.
It wouldn't work because, honestly, when I'm installing a machine, one, I can't be asked to go and look up what all these things that do.
Okay. Maybe it's not devconf then, but you put it somewhere and you make the default send the things that we think are reasonable, but people have the ability, you know, maybe we give them a README that says, by the way, you know, review this and determine if you're uncomfortable sending any of this stuff, even in an anonymous form, and turn it off.
Well, in my understanding, these things, you get the data that you have pre-selected in the defaults, and that's the only statistically significant one, because it will be very few people that bother to actually change the defaults, so you will get very few submissions that kind of change that. So
what are you advocating? Just sending everything?
If there can be a same default that doesn't bother people, we can do that. And otherwise, it's probably more Calvin's work.
I guess, for example, if Petter could put together a list of things that he would be comfortable sharing, we are on the same side.
So we define Peter as the most paranoid
person.
I think Bill is more paranoid. The other popcorn guy.
But I think we've already agreed that most of us would be uncomfortable sending the DMI decode data. Well, maybe not most of us, but at least some of us would be. But we also agreed that's one of the most useful things because it gives us data about specific hardware uses, and that would allow us as Debian to go to those hardware vendors and be able to say, you know, there's 10,000 machines running Debian, you need to do drivers.
We don't need to provide the whole DMID code to have the most meaningful information. The most meaningful information are probably 4 or 5 lines out of the hundreds one.
Yeah.
And it's maybe not the most sensitive one.
Just the scenario about like we going approaching a vendor and saying we have 10,000 machines running to prove the drive, is that really a realistic
scenario? Yes,
they asked about that.
Okay.
And I work for a vendor, and I will go to my manager and say, look, there's 10,000 people running this machine. This is what we need to fix.
Okay. I just, you know.
But from my point of view, and I'm like the hard protection kind of guy, I would like to have at least one report from every kind of hardware. Because that would make it a lot easier for me, because then I could actually check the PCI IDs. So the statistics of it doesn't really matter that much to me. I see it's very useful when talking to vendors, but at the moment it's more like, do this kind of hardware exist at all? Or is it just an entry in the PCI list? And I suspect that if someone just went ahead and implemented or uploaded the hardware database packet from Ubuntu, and that's a menu entry that the user has to manually select and submit once information about this hardware. So it's not a regular update, and it doesn't make sense to do a regular update because hardware doesn't change every week. That will help me a lot with the Discover work and the hardware detection stuff.
So how about shifting the collection phase to something like contribute to Debian kind of menu that can send people to the list of orphan packages that they have installed, dev tags, pages to categorize what they have installed, a tool that sends other information, you know, do a kind of contribute to Debian package that among the various options have send a whole lot of things on an encrypted SSH HTTPS connection to it, so the man doesn't see it, at least to trust Debian. If you don't trust your internet provider, it's a way a bit better. That could probably be a better channel to harvest the hell out of things, and also correlate with Popcorn Ashes, which you can read from the Popcorn log.
We could also promise to lock out a notebook or so.
No.
Participating.
No, you don't need to make a contest. It's just, I mean,
just sweet menu.
I mean, lots of people put their configurations online, either so they've got a record of what they set up, so they know how to reset it up and then reinstall, or to help other people who have got and bought the same notebook with the same hardware configuration. I mean, a lot of people put those pages online.
Yeah, you can make like an auto page generator.
And you could say, yeah, if you turn it into something like that, rather than a system where people are just submitting random data, where people can say, well, I can look up this data hardware, or I can look up this hardware and see how compatible it is.
It could be a MySpace for your hardware. Think about it.
My computer.
And you could have flashy graphics, and all your friends linking there, saying what a great computer you have.
So you joke, but I worked on a PRS Linux port, and there's a hwdb.prs-linux.org, and people did a similar thing. HWinfo didn't exist at the time, but there was a tool that HP had that ran under HPX, and early on in the port, people also had HPX on machines. You ran that, and it outputted all sorts of information about the hardware, and then you uploaded this thing to the website and parsed it and put it all in there, but then you could also register yourself, and so if you go to that page, you can find, you can search by model or by other things, and once you get them all to that page, it lists all your friends that have that machine. And so there are other people you could talk to who are like, hey, can you try this, or that sort of thing.
Yeah, I definitely like the idea of making this fun.
I also like the idea that if it's for hardware, a big lever is your hardware not really well supported in Debian, click this, report your thing.
Yeah.
So you actually report, I'm having a problem with this hardware setup, which could be actually a motivational thing
that would fit into the first Debian.
And it's motivational, and then if we collect lots of problems with one specific bit of hardware, we can go and chase people and say, yeah.
It's a three-way system. You have this aspect, and as of the way around, it becomes, I want to buy a ThinkPad T60, and does it work well? And which model should I choose?
That's more difficult, because that means reporting with also this work, this doesn't. So I have a problem with, my SD card reader, and I would send a problematic hardware report for my entire laptop, while the video card is perfect. So,
the whole because the human thing is just is really more precise. It says, does your home train it?
Does your sound card work and it plays a sound and you press OK or not? And does your video card work and press OK or not? And that kind of information actually provides it.
For installation reports does a lot of
things already.
Yeah. And there's probably a lot of information we could actually pull through because people do
they use
PCI, USB.
And the installation report actually includes the MID call, I think.
Yeah.
Because I'm pretty sure I wrote that part of it.
Yes. Also, it could be two-way. I mean, we could have the status. If some people have problems with it, they could modify a wiki page identified by the hardware setup, and then if somebody the next one calls it up, they get the wiki page. Well, that's just a possibility which I'm just coming up with.
The third thing.
Well, no, but it's just about data mining and hardware related things, because I think that if you data mine from time to time, you can also be proactive regarding problems with specific hardware. For example, I have a TV card in my computer and it stops working with the TV, for example. And in fact, I think in Popcorn, you will see that I begin to use less the TV. As I was using it a lot with my card, and I begin to use I don't know, K3V or something like that. I don't remember the other.
XAWTV?
XAWTV, yes. Or another tool, I don't remember the name. that's something under KDE. And we can be proactive regarding that, because no one reports a bug, but you know that. So they begin to stop using my package, all the people that have, I don't know, MPEG, USB 2 decoder, and it can be something interesting.
Yeah, useful for package maintainers.
What?
Useful for package maintainers to be able to see
that
these relationships exist. That wow, you know, people who have this hardware don't use my package or
why stops using my package.
Who stops using or uninstall it and don't use it? I don't have the hardware, but I discover that.
But actually, before we said we don't want to have the same idea with the hardware and the packages. Well, from my point of view, I want to have it
because that's why you can't see it.
Yeah.
What I was interested this more comments than this. I was going back to what Erica says. Is that if during the work here, both yesterday, we were discussing about this. Is I'm quite interested in the getting people having better support for the laptop hardware and so on. Because today many people write some how to install Debian on my Macintosh, and so right now on the wiki on Debian home page, I'm trying to set up something so to help people write report, and one of the key things that I'm currently doing on the wiki is say people insert ULS PCI in the page, insert the ULS USB, and have some problems with the MID code, but.
Run the bug script for discover data. It provides all the useful information about your hardware.
Should we just decide on a name so we can just coordinate this up future on the wiki? Like, should we just call it HWDB or something on the wiki page?
I suggest we just copy the packet from Ubuntu. I don't see the point of re-implementing that thing.
But yeah, I'm not suggesting re-implementing, just for future coordination or something. For the ideas that we've been talking about there. And did we decide, did we decide that we're going to have this information public or not?
Probably be like PopCon, and most of it will be private, but results of processing it will be public.
So PopCon is not public, I thought.
Aggregated data is.
Yeah, the aggregated data. we can get information how many installed something or used something, but that's all.
Debian developers can get everything.
Yeah.
Because obviously I was thinking just if you syndicated it to somebody else, because it is a bit of a task to do everything. If we just provided the data, maybe. Anyway, so yeah, wiki.debian.org, HWDB. Everyone's happy with that?
Sure. What about a mailing list? Is this really a QA exercise? Or is this something different? I mean, it, you know, can just discuss on the Debian QA list. I don't know if people are subscribed
to that. I'm not even subscribed to that list.
I think it's more or less everything.
Yeah.
Oh, I would see support. He would see
maybe popularity content,
data mining, and some other things.
Keep it on popularity. There's popularity.
It's not much traffic there. Maybe it's
okay.
A good starting point.
Yeah.
That sounds like a sensible idea.
So,
I should also mention that some Fedora guys started an effort to make a hardware database for Linux, and they were very enthusiastic a few weeks, and then it stopped. They also called it HWDB. So the idea has been discussed quite a lot, and as far as I know, Ubuntu and SUSE is the only one actually implementing something like that.
They have a roof, that's one.
Well, and if we use similar software, then you'd be able to aggregate databases too, and then the Linux community as a whole could say, hey, hardware vendor, you know, there are this many Debian, this many Fedora, whatever, but altogether there are this many Linux machines, and
yeah.
So you should do drivers. So it would be good to work in such a way that we could work with the other distros as well.
Yeah.
Where's the popcorn menu?
It's a wallet, and it's called Popcom Developers Pass.
It's on the line, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, Popcom Developers.
While we're here, I guess many people don't know how Popcom does data collection. And when we were discussing it, we came up with ideas of improving it. Is it worth kind of explaining it to a wider public, just in case people can find out better collection ideas, because Popcom is accurate for some packages, but only for some. You want to explain it? Should I go on?
Well, I can assure you it's not accurate for any packet, but it's fairly accurate for a few of them. I can go on. I don't know how many programmers are here, but I assume all of you are, so I'll just show you the code.
Does this work?
Should work.
Red-based client in Ubuntu has a GNOME and a KDE version, and that's what the KDE version I got. But the Popcom scripts, this is going to be an interesting read, I think. That is entirely fine. Yeah, we should change that.
So
Oh, the collection count. This is the loop, looping over all the packages. And for each packet, it loops over all the files. And if the file matches this regular expression, it's taken into account. And if it doesn't, it's not taken into account.
Someone can't see. You've got the opposite side. Someone else can't see.
Step behind.
Yeah. So it's a project. It's a small one, okay? And what I've been adjusting the last few days is this regular expression. And the point is that popularity contest collects if a packet is installed, if it was used the last week, and the usage part is the tricky part, if it was used recently, like I think that's the last month, and if it was well, unused, if all the access dates are the same as the installation, well, if all the packages have the same access date, that's assumed to be the installation date, I think. Something like that. And there is quite a lot of packages that do not have any files that matches this regular expression. They end up as the no file packages in the statistics. So anyway, comparing the A time and hitting the file that was most recently used in the packet that matches this regular expression and report that alongside with the information about the packet. And the problem is, of course, that access time is inaccurate for a few packages. All libraries in lib will be accessed every night when the cron job to update the library, well, ld.so cache is updated. A few other things are like manual pages are processed every night when the index of manual pages is updated. So all these files, there's no use to actually check if they have been used or not, because we know they have been used and it doesn't mean anything. Also, a few packages changes from having no binaries to getting one binary in some release of Debian. And then you will have some packages showing up with access times, and some machines showing up with access times for that packet, and some showing up with no files, and then you will get a really interesting result for that packet. And you have the boot system.map file, which is only accessed when the system boots. So that is not really usage of the kernel packet. It's how recently was the machine booted, kind of usage of the kernel packages. So kernel packages can be compared to each other on the relative frequency of boots. And they cannot be compared to user packages, because that vote is actually usage.
Possible improvement. Is it worth patching ldso cache to restore the A time just like updateDB does?
Probably, that would be nice.
With a switch, so you only activate it during an overnight.
But the access time is only updated on machines where the access time is activated on the file system. And for laptops, it's quite common to mount file system with no A time option to avoid touching the A time every time you touch a file, to avoid touching the disk every time you access the file. And for those, there is, well, you can't use the A time to detect votes, of course. There have been proposals to enable accounting, and which will then log all process use in var log, and then process the accounting information and use that information to report usage or not. But then we are getting pretty far off.
If you enable that in my laptop, I'm going to set fire on you.
That's one problem, yeah. But it will burn power, battery power on laptops, and that kind of defeats the purpose of the no A time.
But then at least you can mine the libraries just like you mine everything else.
Yeah.
We could check like for non points if it's mounted no A time or with A time, and do another check or something.
do that, they don't get votes.
Yeah.
They still count installations.
It would be like a really small improvement, just really, yeah. Really small.
And we also have the problem that some installations have broken Deepaket database, for example. There must be something like that, because the number of installed popularity contest packages is smaller than the number of submissions.
Right.
Not by a huge amount, it's like a fraction of a percent, but still, there are some machines reporting popularity contests that didn't have popularity contests installed, and that's not possible. There's also some machines that report unknown architecture, and the number is higher than it should be when I compare it to the number of installations with an old enough popularity contest version, a popularity contest packet that the architecture was not reported at all. So there are some machines where the dpacket command we use to extract the architecture is actually not reporting anything useful.
Maybe that are developers or something, or?
No, I don't think so. Well, I've seen the same in Ubuntu, and Ubuntu only have had a popularity contest version that I've reported architecture.
Okay.
They still have like 200 unknown machines with unknown architecture.
Maybe possible to do something looking at the depends and apps to figure out which libraries are being used by recently used packages.
It could be, but then it's going to be very complex. It's unlikely we will implement that.
I'm not sure what you said. I just
just look at package depends to try and then look at which packages are being accessed recently to figure out libraries.
Oh yeah, I was going to use some ideas. If a library is installed and nobody depends on it, just remove it.
I don't know if you actually removed it in the last few weeks or something, but until a few weeks ago, I already also saw some suggestion with the time of like 2036 or something in the future. Mm-hmm. And I think it was a really old submission without even an architecture. So it was just some screwed up system submitting.
Right. Down to 36 sounds like all bits to one in the time T.
Yeah, something like that. I know that a lot of power PCs, the old ones, when they're dealing the NVRAM, they boot up with time of 1900. So I think that is filtered out now. But when I started doing a lot of stuff with the popcorn data, I had a lot of submissions with a time of.
Right, I don't think we actually filter that data, we just store it. So, but we remove it after 30 days, so.
Yeah, that's.
Then we stop reporting, I guess. Yeah. As you can see here, there is quite a lot of strange architectures, and a few of them is really interesting.
Yeah.
I don't know what that is.
It's unreadable.
Okay, it's a i486 architecture.
You can increase.
We have two machines reporting with the i486 architecture, and as far as I know, we don't have that.
Probably somebody built the whole thing from scratch. Probably somebody.
Into user in Debian, yeah, maybe.
Are there any OpenBSD architectures out?
No, we have only FreeBSD. At least you can see the number of unknowns is 231. That's architectures unknown, and the version number is 310. And we did introduce the architecture before the version number of popularity contest. But still, this number of unknowns has not really kept going down. It increases over here. And that would mean that someone actually installed Voodoo. A large number of Voodoo installations, and I don't think so.
You could be surprised. I mean, there could be a big data center that still runs Voodoo and keeps up the machines.
Then it would be installed at that point, and it would be in this year.
That was around March this year.
Yeah, that would be around the release of Edge.
Yeah. So I believe that's Edge installations with something broken in.
Suppose that Google has a production environment in Voodoo, and they don't want to leak test their whole amazing lot of stuff they run on it.
But I don't think there's a popcorn to ask.
The reason I don't like
they have more than 200 machines.
Right. Yeah. It was somewhat smaller than Google, but with whatever. It's like just you know a cluster. Yeah.
The reason I don't believe it is that these numbers actually show 38 unknown architecture. So that's Ubuntu, and they have never released a packet or popularity model that didn't collect architecture.
One of the things that you'll need to look out for, especially if you're going to try and start selling this data to vendors in the future, is how are you going to stop data poisoning? How are you going to stop vendor X injecting a whole bunch of bogus reports saying that, that their package or their hardware is the best hardware to run it, artificially inflating their market share?
Yeah.
Similarly, how do you stop Ubuntu or Red Hat poisoning our database and saying, well, Debian's results are rubbish? And
of course, you can't poison the popularity contest at the moment.
Yeah.
There is no check to.
Yeah.
So that's the point of being anonymous, that is poisonable, basically.
Yeah.
So no one's done that yet?
It's possible
that somebody did it or even doesn't.
Yeah, I know. There's no way to find out.
You can even submit a huge number of packages or your own name or whatever as package.
Yeah, I was starting to think like with more people using virtualization. You could just make private machines and
Well, if you're trying to poison it with a script, then you could inject.
It's not so much spam, but just people who generally have a with virtualization. There could be just a lot of machines generally that might skew things.
For example, this jump was Swedish cluster of AMD machines. Apparently, they stopped recording for a while and then came back.
Yeah, they turned off the network.
I don't know what happened there, but I do know the guy actually maintaining that cluster. So I know that that was a Swedish AMD cluster. And he asked if it was okay for us that he actually reported one entry for each machine in the cluster because they are identical. And we said if they are physical real machines, well, if they are real machines, go ahead. Even virtual machines are real machines in that sense. So if they are actually like doing something, go ahead, report them.
That's an interesting point you're raising. How do you do it? Do you have in PubCon, do you have any clues at what percentage is actual virtual machine or physical machine?
I haven't looked for that. I guess
we
could try and see for SAN installations, but no.
You can guess by installation of the kernels, if they're using our kernels. Then we have our official kernel image, Linux image 2.6.18-xamp.
Well, getting around the poisoning problem, what about asking people to register?
So I'm not going to say
No. I would rather stay the way it is until we know it's a problem.
If we ever get into this problem,
That's cool. That's good.
I think it's better just cancel everything if they start poisoning it. Because the whole purpose is like gone. It's
not
going to provide feedback to the Debian boot and Debian CD people to improve the distribution, and if that's the way you provide information to help them, well,
yeah, it might be
you.
A big waste of time.
And at that time, we would have actually real privacy information. I mean, we could really map one person to something.
Yeah.
I was thinking, though, looking at that peak about the cluster, that when you start giving suggestions based on PopCon, basically, the guy that turns on 500 machines with PopCon enabled starts suggesting everyone to install the same package that they have. Which, I mean, luckily there's many clusters and so on.
Yeah.
But, okay, the amount of identical machines I have is a good push, let's say, on a suggested package. I mean, not a big deal. I think it will be watered down quite a bit by the whole merging with all other things, so it's not much of a problem.
Oh, it's really the relative weights, isn't it? It's if this package is twice as much as this package, then you figure it's got a larger user base.
Yeah.
Not so much there's 2,000 users for this one, there's 1,000 users for that. It's really the scale of relativity.
More than two packages,
using data mining, it doesn't matter because no typical user will have the identical configuration as cluster.
Yeah, cool.
So the amount actually doesn't matter.
interesting things to read from that compared to this version graph is that there are approximately 3 times as many users of stable than unstable, or unstable and testing. The green one here, that's actually the stable install, that's edge installations. And this is unstable and testing. And you also see the long tail. It takes quite a long time before everyone upgrades. There's a 5 million installations.
How long is that long tail? I can't really tell.
Well, we don't know. It's very rarely it goes to zero.
Like can you average it out and say it takes...
Well, you can just measure it like this now. So no. I would say...
This is Woody. This is Sarge. This is Edge. So there is 1900 of 53 or 54,000, I'm not sure, 54,000 running Woody.
Oh, so you need to change the format of the report so that you can generate the same graph for each package?
We are not going to do it because it's done by the QA people. But the graph is dead because the machine runs on the memory.
To collect version number.
No, we don't want that. We consider that too much.
Because you can track bugs.
Well, we can track users. If we know what version the machine has, we can track it over time.
At the moment, if it would be evil, we have the IP, we have the packages the user has installed, we have the approximate last update he did, if he is using unstable, because we have the last 5 minutes, okay?
Actually, we don't have the IP address. It's thrown away after we use
it. But we could lock it if he would be evil.
Yeah.
And then we could run an attack. And if you would have versioning information about each package, it would be even worse. But actually,
you can presumably imply versioning information from version of Popcorn.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So it's interesting to keep an eye on these numbers. I even get an email.
Is there another talk coming up?
A meeting.
The number of architecture, or the distribution of architectures, how that changes over time. It's quite interesting to see that ARM, for example, is the fastest growing architecture at the moment. Not very surprising, but we have it over there.
ARM and not AMD64.
AMD64 is not growing that fast.
Cool.
The reason ARM's growing is because of all the embedded devices.
Yeah.
I say cool.
And slugs and, yeah.
Have you got a slide? Have you got a slide?
Yep.
I got a bar on.
I have one.
Architecture is indeed very good.
Yeah, it is.
Architecture is the architecture as known by DBKG. So if you have an AMD64 system, you start with an H286 system, it records H286.
Yeah.
What's below ARM?
This is a logarithmic graph, so this is like 0, 1, 2.
I mean, do I see the. Because if it's logarithmic, so if I sum ARMEB, it doesn't become 3 times.
RDB has 9 and RDL has 6.
Oh. So what's below
ARM? Okay, sorry, I thought they were sort of.
No, it's
all the colors become quite similar.
The one below ARM is PowerPC.
Okay.
Can you increase the
Not for an image.
So these are that's a sorted list of architectures.
That could be increasable, I suppose.
Yeah, sorry, I can't do that at the moment. So the first one is 386, 85%, AMD64, 11.2%, ARM, 1.4%, PowerPC, 1.2%, Spark, 1.5%, Alpha, 1.1%, Nipsen 1.1, HPPA 1.1, 0.1, sorry, I'm reading wrong. So these are above 1%. PowerPC, ARM, and D64, I36, and the rest is below 1%. M68K, where is it? 0.02%. And it's been pretty stable there for the last 12.5 years, I think.
It's the same people.
No, the number has actually increased slightly from like 2 to 9.
Right?
But 0.02% approximately all the time.
I turned them on.
Someone turned them on. Okay, so time is up, so I think we should...
I saw changes that could be planned that I have in my notes. One is to patch a diso cache to survey times. The other is to add support for packages to provide a file with pvolt file that one could look for, like web applications could tell you, actually look at the access time of VAR.w something. Mm-hmm. And third change is a server-side dev queue in which it would tell me new files that enter and new files that exit the data set, which then I can use to, one could use to keep parallel indexes and other mining things up to date.
Yeah.
That's what I have as a note so far of improvements on infrastructure.
Send an email to the list and
see what
we can manage.
Okay. People, I'm very sorry to interrupt. We are just about to have a meeting in this room.
Yeah.
Okay.
We just got a red card. It's time on.
Yeah. No.